Let's talk about big data and its challenges. So dealing with large data sets is challenging when we talk about big data analytics, but also in computational science. There have been identified five so-called V's that characterize what are big data challenges. So the first V is volume, which is amount of data. Second V is velocity, the speed at which data is generated. The third one is variety, that you have different types of data. And we have veracity, which is the trustworthiness of the data. And finally, we have value, which means data generates value and our data has a low value. Let's look at all those individual characteristics and find out what is big data and what isn't, and characterize them further. So in terms of volume, when we talk about a couple of gigabytes of data, that is normally not big data because you can do this on your own PC. You can process the data and in sufficient time. When you talk about terabytes to tens of petabytes of data, that surely is big data. And here you find a couple of examples of corpus, corpi, that and their data sizes. Like Wikipedia has about 10 terabytes of data with its history. Google Search Index has about 46 gigaweb pages. That's a lot. And YouTube had in 2012 about 76 petabytes of data ingested. Yep, that is kind of big data. Velocity, which is the data volume we generate per time. Okay, when we have a never changing data set, that is not big data. You can optimize for the data and you can process it. When we talk about big data, we mean that some data is constantly generated, or well, nearly constantly, like at the rate, for example, at 30 gigabytes a second to 30 gigabytes per second. That accumulates then to about 900 gigabytes a year or 900 petabyte a year. That's a huge amount of data. So even with 30 gigabytes a second that you can generate with a couple of sensors, you can get a huge volume of data. Okay, the Large Hadron Collider in CERN, which with all the experiments generated at some time 25 gigabytes a second. The Square Kilometer Array, which was planned in 2018 to create about 700 terabytes a second. You have about 50,000 Google searches per second and a lot of Facebook activity, of course. So in that sense, let's have a look a little bit into data sources. So we have enterprise data, which is stuff like customer information, typically covered into transactions. Purchases, like you know what you buy in your grocery when you do grocery shopping. Enterprise data has the characteristic that it bundles somehow the business objectives and it's well defined what you collect. Okay, so it's clear what you collect and you collect it for the purpose of business. The next aspect is experimental and observational data, EUD. Well, that is created by machines from sensors or devices. It can be trading systems, satellites, microscopes, video streams, smart meters. Okay, this is machine-generated data. Somehow, people have built the machines, of course, but it's machine-generated. And finally, we have social media. Well, this data is typically created by humans, and its messages, posts, blogs, wikis, of course, videos and stuff are also part of this. So, as part of the data, we have different variety of data, which means the types of data that we see. We have, first of all, structured data. What is structured data? It's like a table with fixed attributes, okay? Like if I would write down for the number of students, what is your name? What is your birthday? And maybe, you know, the amount of money you would like to earn in the future. So this is well handled by relational databases, traditionally. Then we have unstructured data. This is data typically generated by humans, like natural language, voices, video, Wikipedia stuff. So you must process this data first to gain some value out of it. By processing, we typically use semi-structured data. So that means we have some structure into unstructured data, but this kind of structures may change with the document that we see. And HTML for the web and JSON files are examples of semi-structured data. Big data typically means that you have data from multiple sources and in multiple of those forms listed here. And you certainly involve semi-structured data at least, and often also unstructured data that you process further. So if you talk only about structured data, that is business kind of data. It's not typically a big data problem. Okay, veracity is the trustworthiness of data. Well, what is big data? Well, the data that you actually collect has some uncertainty and is ambiguous. Those mistakes can be introduced by humans and machines. For example, when you share an account, right? You have a payback card, you go to a shop, how about you share this account? Or you use the payback account only some day and not another day, you have forgotten it. So the data that you get in that sense doesn't reflect the truth. You may have also systems that have wrong timestamps and so on. However, data quality is really vital when you try to do some kind of analysis with the data and conclusions, of course. So if you have garbage data and a perfect model, you still get a garbage result. That's obvious, right? So even with the perfect model, you would get garbage result. But if you have the perfect data and a garbage model, then you get garbage results as well, right? So what you should have is you have good data and a good model, and then you get a good output. So the idea, well, someone has phrased it as GIGO paradigm, garbage in, garbage out, right? Garbage model, garbage data in, well, you get garbage out. You can't afford to do that. So the value of data. So typically in big data, raw data is of low value. Well, a single observation of the weather, so today at 9 a.m. it's 25 degrees, that's of low value. A bill is of low value. The output of a large-scale climate simulation may cost, for example, 10,000 euro, but you still have to analyze the data to come to conclusions, right? So this raw data that you generate is of low value if you don't create really conclusions from it. So the idea is that you use analytics and theory about the data to increase the value. So really you analyze and transform the big data into smart and valuable data. And there are different, you know, representations of this kind of workflow, and I just illustrate you a couple of them to create a general understanding. I think the details don't matter too much, but it is important that you understand the key idea. Okay, so we have the raw data collected. Now, the first question that we typically may ask is, you know, what happened in this data? Okay, what do we see? So we do some kind of exploration and find out what happened. This is called a descriptive analysis. The next level is we diagnose why did this happen, and or sometimes you want to ask what went wrong, right? Why did people vote for this person and not for that person? The next step is predictive analysis. What will happen? And finally, a prescriptive analysis, which means what should we do and why should we do it? Okay, so the value of all these analyses increases significantly from the bottom to the top. And also there is a time component here. So typically when we look at our data is from the past. Even if it's real time, it is from the past. We can describe the data, we can diagnose the data. And then we reach the present, we want to make a prediction what will happen in the future. Right? Or we want to find out what should be our strategy in the future. That is where the value lies. So in computational science, actually, we see a similar kind of steps when we perform simulation runs. So we have to analyze, first of all, we have to analyze our simulation, which can be considered to have produced raw data. Okay, but also the term of prediction and prescription, these kind of aspects, they are typically part of how we have created our simulation, okay? So when I do the simulation of a tokamak reactor, right, I put in a couple of parameters that I play with, and I may come to the prediction that a certain, you know, construction method of this tokamak reactor produces the best efficiency, which then leads to the prescription, which would be use this and these parameters to build a tokamak reactor and so forth, right? That's basically a relationship that we can see, a loose relationship, but those steps they need to be performed. Also in a simulation, when you run an application, you have to diagnose if the data, you know, is making sense and why is it behaving like it does. Okay, there is another abstraction of analytics. When we talk about on the x-axis now about time, we look in the past on the left side and into the future on the right side. So in the future is prediction, the past is basically analysis or exploration. So real-time reporting typically means, for instance, that we talk about seconds to minutes in the past in which you get some report, so you know, okay, 10 minutes ago this was what has been sold in this outlet across Europe. That's an interesting information, maybe. Then we have traditional reporting. Traditional reporting is really back in, you know, in the past, quite. So what happened last year, for example, last week, and so on. And you deal with a lot of unstructured data and external data with high data volumes. So that's shown here on the y-axis, is the volume. So with traditional reporting, we can process zettabytes, possibly, of data. But that means not in real time. Then we have real time reporting for smaller amounts of data and so on. And you can see we have, in the future, we talk about ad hoc decision supports, operational planning, which goes from days to months, and strategic planning, which is years in the future. Okay, so this is another view, and there are many of those that you can look at. Finally, I want to show how we perform big data analytics. So traditionally, we work in phases. First, we have to discover the data, then we have to integrate the data, means to make it ready, and then we exploit the data. Okay, so sub pieces are, when you discover the data, you have to collect the data and annotate it to make sure that you know what you know you have been collecting. Then you prepare the data, you organize the data, and then you integrate it into your computing system to make it ready to be analyzed. You analyze the data, you visualize the data, of course, and you make decisions based on your outcomes, like your visualizations. Right, analysis tools here can be machine learning, statistics, and interactive visualization. Often you have limitations by looking through prepared results because the data volumes that you kind of integrated here can be so huge that you have to kind of do that, how to say, not interactive, but you have to make a decision. I want to look at those aspects, all of them, and then you can look at those refined data sets. So there is an indirect feedback between visualization, analysis, and decision making that isn't shown here. But basically, you can think of that actually here is an arc from making decisions back to analysis. So you try to make a decision, but you find out, well, the analysis wasn't sufficient. Well, you go back to the analysis, and then you change the analysis to visualize new data, and so forth, until you are happy. So there has been the concept of the so-called data lake. People have the idea that basically you can collect everything. So the idea is if you combine data from any source and any type and dump it into a lake, what we call a lake, right? Then you can do any kind of analysis in this lake and don't miss any opportunity, which is great for business. So the attributes or the characteristics of this idea are that you collect really everything. Anything that you can collect, just dump it, okay? And at the point when you do the analysis, you make the decision what data is important and you decide what schema, in the sense of a database, you apply when reading the data. Then, once you have collected everything, you can dive into this lake, okay? Funny expression, I know. That means that you can have these users across the business units to refine, explore, and enrich the data based on their own terms. So you have this data lake, but they basically look at the data and create their own view on this data based on their condition and whatever they you know want to do and look at. And you have to have flexible access to do this. So that means you have to have some kind of shared infrastructure. And there are different ways of accessing data. Interactive is the best. You can search in data, like with Google, for example. You can do online analysis. And batch means you have a couple of operations that you want to do. You write them together, then you submit a batch job and you wait until they are completed.